I'm thinking back about when we started about 8 years ago, 9 years ago, what the situation was like on the island, and particularly around here, which we knew best, around the Nihiwatu area. And there was a lot of poverty, but with that came severe illness and hardship on a lot of levels. When Klaus came, we started, you know, the kernel of the idea of trying to solve malaria. From there, it's grown into a massive health initiative that covers malnutrition, surgery, all manners of things that are really helping people. And now when you go around to the villages, it's clearly obvious, you know, what's going on. And you'll see some changes. Mostly people are healthier, cleaner. For me, thinking back 21 years ago when I was here, this whole area here was seemed to be a wasteland. There was no farms anywhere. It was really grim. And now this area here is covered with farms, mostly subsistence farming still, but we've been introducing all manners of better farming methods. This started 3 years ago, and now it's very encouraging to see people are coming to us and asking us for tractors, asking us for water pumps, asking us for the seeds. They're growing crops that were foreign to them not so long ago. In the villages, it's clearly obvious that in the core group where we started 8-9 years ago, with mosquito nets, with water, putting clinics around where people had access to come and get medical aid when they needed it, and proper diagnosis. You see kids now going to school, they're healthy, they're fat, they're plump, far less are dying, and it's very encouraging to see this.
As for the malaria control program, the biggest thing that has happened in 2010 is that we managed to open a malaria training center. During 2009, we worked very hard to establish the facility so we could perform teaching and certification.
This year, the center will graduate over 100 health workers who in turn will treat and diagnose more than 300,000 patients over the next year.
Going to make a big difference in diagnosis by tens of thousands of people over the next 3-4 years. We're probably talking about a couple hundred thousand proper diagnoses a year, and that's a big deal on this island where malaria is still one of the big killers. One of the things I'm personally most proud of is to see children, you know, young teens coming here, getting involved with their parents, and going home and actually fundraising on their own within their school and coming back with thousands of dollars, toothbrushes by the duffel bag full. School lunch programs initially started by children, helping children. Mosquito nets. There's a girl here, Mackenzie. She's out in the villages right now as we speak.
Super cool.
Malaria seemed like to be an issue that was very big, so I chose to start working on it and doing fundraisers back at home. And we're going to go unwrap the nets and show them how to use it.
These are like young kids. You know, when I was that age, we never even imagined, you know, what the world was like, let alone get involved and help other people.
You know, you have an opportunity to sponsor specific projects that mean something to you, but you also have an opportunity to go there and see it with your family.
Not very long ago, the schools were in terrible condition here. It was a very low priority from the government. In total, there's over 3,200 kids now in 13 schools that we support. They're healthy, they're getting education outside of the normal school system. We have Rainey going and Rudy, and they teach hygiene and nutrition, things that are going to help them go back to the village and support themselves and their families. We have scholarships we've been doing in the last 4 years. Some of those kids have already graduated. They're working in the clinics. And that is absolutely amazing, and that really, you know, makes me quite proud to have been able to make some sort of a contribution on that level. It's hard to imagine living in the West, that you grow up, turn a faucet on, and there's water. It's almost impossible to imagine what life would be like without it. And it's been the foundation of everything we do, and we build on top of that. It is the thing that makes it all happen.
We really want to go beyond a relatively narrow area of about 5% of the population to try to help as many people as possible on the whole island of Sumba. Interplast team came back to Sumba and performed a number of operations, plastic surgery operations on many, many, primarily kids from Sumba. People came in from all over the island, East Sumba, Central Sumba, and West Sumba.
There's no way we could do it without these surgeons coming up to do eye surgery.
The heartbreaking thing when we come here is we see people who have been blind for ages who really shouldn't be. We see elderly people who really should have been operated on years prior.
When you see the difference of somebody walking in, some young child 6 years old that can't see, and then walking out 45 minutes later and he's crying, but he's crying because he's scared of what he's seeing. He's never seen stuff before.
Can't go to school, if you can't thread the needle to make a dress to sell to someone else or to trade, then you go hungry.
It's a pleasure to go back to the villages and walk around, and you can point out children who wouldn't be here today if it hadn't been for the Sumba Foundation Health Program.
Literally saved moments, hours from death, to see that and to know that through donors' gifts, this has enabled us to be able to save lives on this level.
They're grateful for anything that we can do, but there's a piece about them that I think we can learn from. And we've been able to make great strides to help them.